Find your Bible, and I want you to open to the book of 1 Peter. If you don't know where 1 Peter is, you can start at the end and work your way left, and you'll probably find it. If you don't have a Bible, we provide some in the seat back right there in front of you. You're welcome to take that. And if you don't own one, just take that Bible, and it will be our gift to you, just as a way of saying thanks for being here today. And you can keep that Bible. 1 Peter chapter 1, and we'll look at verses 3-5. I heard a story about a granddad who wanted to know, how much about Easter does my little 4-year-old granddaughter know? And he thought she would give the kind of answer that kids give typically. If he were to ask her about Easter, he thought she'd say something about candy and Easter eggs and a nice dress and the Easter bunny and the basket, right? But he grabbed his little granddaughter and he put her on his lap and he said, "Sweetheart, I want you to tell me, what is Easter all about?" She said, "Granddaddy, I know what Easter's about." He said, "Okay, tell me." She said, "Easter is about when Jesus Christ died on the cross, and they got him off the cross, and they put him in a grave, and he was in the grave for 3 days, and after 3 days, there was an earthquake, and the stone rolled away, and Jesus was alive." The granddaddy was so thrilled. He's like, "My little 4-year-old granddaughter, she's a genius. She knows all about Easter." But she wasn't finished. And she said, and that earthquake that happened, right after that earthquake, the entire town came out by the grave. And if Jesus came out and saw his shadow, they knew there'd be 6 more weeks of winter. At least she had part of the story right. And I want you to know, it's important for us to get the story right. The story of Jesus, the story of the resurrection, the gospel story. Let's make sure we have it right. If there was anything that gives us hope in this life, it is the resurrection of Jesus Christ. If there's anything that when we face difficulties or challenges in our lives, if there's any way that we know we can have hope, it is because Jesus is alive. This is why we gather every week, every day for the believer in Jesus Christ is a celebration of the resurrection. Every moment of the day, we know that Jesus lives. And you ask me how I know he lives. He lives within my heart. We know that he lives. This offers hope. Every Sunday is a celebration of an empty tomb, a celebration that Jesus is alive. And the reality of the empty tomb gives us hope. That's why I want you to know today that hope lives. That's what we see in 1 Peter chapter 1 and verses 3-5. Hope lives. The hope of forgiveness, the hope of peace, the hope of joy, the hope of assurance, the hope of heaven one day. Jesus offers hope in this life and in the life to come. I'm not sure there's a sadder word in the English language than the word hopeless. Hopeless. I'm not sure there's a more sad, disappointing, empty word. Hopeless. I saw a picture of a report card from 1941. A 7th grade report card, and it had the regular grading scale on the back of it that you would typically recognize, A, B, C, D, and F. But then there was another letter. There was another letter beyond F. There was the word G. Did you ever know there was a G, that you could get a G in school? 1941, 7th grade report card. And of course, out by a letter A, B, C, D, and F, their words are explanations. So F stands for failure. But there's something worse than failure. What in the world could that be? Outside the letter G, there was a one-word explanation, and the word said, hopeless. Could you imagine, as a 7th grader, getting a report card with all G's? Your teacher thinks you're absolutely hopeless. That is a bad semester, right? But I want you to know today, when it comes to Jesus Christ, there are no hopeless people and there are no hopeless situations. There's not a problem you face or an issue you encounter or a struggle that you have that Jesus Christ can't handle, can't solve, or can't fix. Somebody says there really are no hopeless situations. There are people who've simply grown hopeless about them. So no matter how difficult or dark your life is or the difficulties you encounter, I want you to know today that you can have hope because Jesus Christ is alive. And he's given us a living hope. 1 Peter chapter 1, we'll begin reading in verse 3 and we'll read to verse 5. As we think about this idea today that hope lives. 1 Peter chapter 1 and verse 3. Peter says, "Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. According to his great mercy, he has caused us to be born again to a living hope." You might want to circle that in your Bible. A living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. "To an inheritance that is imperishable, undefiled, and unfading, kept in heaven for you, who by God's power are being guarded through faith for a salvation ready to be revealed in the last time." Join me in prayer. Father, this morning we ask that you would add your blessing to the reading of your words. Spirit of God, have freedom in this place in our lives as you speak and work. Lord, I pray that in this place you would have your will and your way. Cause us to be attentive and to listen not just to a preacher, but to your word and to the voice of the Spirit of God. And help us to remember the power is in your perfect word as we study, as we learn. In Jesus' name, amen. How do we know that hope lives? How do we know that you, that I, can have hope today? I'll tell you a few reasons we see in 1 Peter. Number one, hope lives because God promised it. Hope lives because God promised it. We can have, as this text says, a living hope because God has promised it. How do I know that the resurrection is real? How do I know that Jesus is alive? How do I know that the tomb is empty? Because God promised it. In fact, for centuries in the Old Testament, God had promised that a Messiah would come, that this Savior would come, that he would come offering salvation to all who placed their faith in him, that this Messiah would come, would suffer and would die, but that this Savior would also live again. For centuries in the Old Testament, God promised hope would come. Peter begins here in verse 3. And Peter's just excited. This is what he says. "Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ." And there's an exclamation point at the end of that sentence. He's excited. Basically what he's saying is, wow, praise God. And the reason that Peter is so excited is he's proclaiming that all of this hope that was promised for centuries has been realized in the person of Jesus Christ. "Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, because God promised hope would come. And hope arrived in Jesus." Isaiah chapter 53 tells of the crucifixion. Centuries before Jesus was ever even born, Isaiah prophesied that the Messiah would come and that he would suffer and that he would be pierced for our transgressions, bruised for our iniquities, that the punishment for our sin would be placed upon him. But towards the end of Isaiah 53 and verse 10, it says that his soul will be an offering for our sin. Yet in the same verse, it says his days will be prolonged. How could this suffering Savior die, yet his days be prolonged? The only answer is there's a promise of the resurrection right there in Isaiah chapter 53. A few pages back in Isaiah chapter 25. Listen to what the text says in Isaiah 25 and verse 1. A powerful promise. "Oh Lord, you're my God. I'll exalt you. I'll praise your name, for you've done wonderful things." Look now. "Plans of old, faithful and sure." Isaiah is saying that all of these plans that God has promised for years, for decades, and for centuries will come to pass. Verse 8 and verse 9. "He will swallow up death forever, and the Lord God will wipe away tears from all faces, and the reproach of his people will be taken away, for the Lord has spoken. It'll be said on that day, 'Behold, this is our God. We've waited for him that he might save us. This is the Lord, we've waited for him. Let us be glad and rejoice in his salvation.'" Isaiah is saying that all of this that was promised long ago has now become true in the Savior, in our Messiah, who lives and offers a living hope. God promised it. There was an elderly Christian man who was laying on his deathbed. He'd been sick for quite some time, and his disease had ravaged his body and began to affect his mind. The pastor went to visit this man one day and sat down beside his bed, and the man was tormented mentally. And the pastor said, "Sir, listen, let me pray for you." And he said, "Pastor, listen, all my life I've memorized and studied the Word of God. I believe in God, and I've followed His Word, and I even knew His promises. But now at the end of my life, I can't remember one single promise of God." The pastor knew that this man was being tempted by the enemy. The pastor looked at him and grabbed his hand and he says, "Listen, dear friend, you may not be able to remember any promises of God, but don't you think that God remembers every single one? There's not a promise that God has made that He's ever forgotten. There's not a promise He made that will not come to pass. God keeps His word. He keeps His promises. So today God offers to you and to me salvation, forgiveness for our sins, a home in heaven one day. God promised it. You can take it to the bank. God promised that in this world we'll have trouble, but He's overcome the world. You can take it to the bank. God's promised that you can have peace in every circumstance and situation. You can take it to the bank. God has promised that He can offer freedom from anything. You can take it to the bank. God has promised that He's a miracle worker and can do a miracle in your marriage and your family. You can take it to the bank. Every word of God is sure, and every promise comes to pass. God promised it. Hope lives today because God promised it. Number two, hope lives because Jesus provided it. Jesus provided it. The Bible says, hey, praise God, we're born again now to a living hope. A living hope. So God promises that we can have hope in the darkest of days and the most difficult circumstances of our life. And Jesus delivers on that promise. Jesus, through His life, His death, and His resurrection, now delivers on the promises that were made throughout the Old Testament for centuries. You and I can have hope. Look at what it says in the text in the latter part of verse 3. Those who know Jesus have been born again to a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. If we know Christ, we can have hope because we are born again. We're made new through a living hope that rests on the resurrection of Jesus Christ. So you and I can have hope that lives today because Jesus Christ is alive. We don't place our hope in some dead philosopher or ancient teaching. We base our hope on a living Savior and the living written Word of God. Hope lives. Jesus provided it. In 1 Corinthians 15, Paul says, if the resurrection is only a fairy tale, if this is all just a kid's story, if this is a myth or a legend, if the resurrection really didn't happen, then there is no hope beyond this life. If the resurrection isn't true, Paul says, 1 Corinthians 15 and 18 and 19, Paul says that if in this life only we have hope, then we are of all people to be most pitied. In other words, Christians, if only in this life we have hope and we don't have life or hope for heaven one day, then we ought to be the most pitied and the most miserable people in all the world. But Paul goes on to say in verse 19, listen to what he says, but in fact, Christ has been raised from the dead. So you and I have hope in this life and in the life to come. We have a living hope. A living hope. That's one that has life in it and gives life to you and to me. A living hope is one that extends on and never ceases. It grows greater as time goes on. The world has a way of dashing our hopes and dreams. I've recently learned I never will be an NBA player. The NFL hasn't called lately, and I probably won't make it on the Celebrity Apprentice, right? The world has a way of dashing our hopes and our dreams, and hopes and dreams fade with time. But the beauty of this hope that we have in Jesus Christ is this hope gets greater and stronger as the days go by. The hope that I have in Jesus doesn't fade. It only grows as I grow closer to Him and as the time grows closer when I see Him face to face. Time destroys most hopes. They fade and they die. But the passing of time only makes a Christian's hope more glorious. Many of you have heard of an author named Max Lucado. He wrote a book entitled 6 Hours One Friday. And in this book, he tells of a missionary to Brazil who'd gone to a very remote part of the jungle where a tribe of Indians lived. He had to cross a river to get to this tribe, but he was trying his best to get to them, to get the gospel to them. But he'd also heard that this tribe of Indians had been ravaged by sickness and disease. A contagious disease was sweeping through their village, and they were dying every single day. Well, he knew that there was a hospital not too far away, and if he could just get them across the river and to the hospital, they could be saved, they could be rescued. The only problem was, in this village, every person believed that the river was inhabited by evil spirits. And if they set foot or touched the water, they would surely die. The missionary had a decision to make. How could he get all of these people where they needed to be, to the hospital, by getting them to walk through the water that they thought was cursed? He brought the whole tribe together and they gathered around the river, and he stuck his hand down in the river and brought it back up and said, "Look, see?" They weren't convinced. He splashed water on his face and said, there's nothing here, it's okay. They weren't convinced. He waded into the water, waist deep, and splashed around. They still wouldn't go. Finally, he's back on the shore. He doesn't know what to do, and then he has an idea. With all the tribe watching, he dives into the river, swims as deep as he can go, swims all the way across, and then bursts forth on the other side, raising his hands in victory and in triumph. At that time, all of the villagers began clapping and applauding, and every single one of them walked across where they could receive medical attention. Isn't that what Jesus did for us? On the cross, He didn't just splash around in the shallow end. He wasn't just beaten. He wasn't just bloodied or bruised. He wasn't just hung on a cross. He died for our sins. The Bible says that on the cross, Jesus dove into the depths of the judgment of God and His wrath against sin that we deserve, that He dove into the depths of the grave and death and hell, but on the other side, 3 days later, rose in victory and triumph, offering life to all who place their faith and trust in Him. Hope lives because Jesus is alive. God promised that Jesus provided it. And number three, the gospel proclaims it. The gospel proclaims that you and I can have hope. I want you to know today, no matter what you face in life, no matter the difficulties you've encountered, the struggles that you're experiencing even this very moment, you can have hope. The gospel of Jesus Christ promises it. The Christian life is not just about what you've been saved from. It's also about what you've been saved for. I'm going to say that again because it's my favorite line in the whole message. The Christian life is not just about what you've been saved from. It's about what you've been saved for. You see, grace covers my past, but hope brightens my future. I mean, if Jesus had just forgiven us and saved us and redeemed us, that would be enough. But that's not all He did. He promises us a hope and a future so that this world is not all there is and we have a home in heaven one day if we know Him. Notice what it says. We have a hope, a living hope, because of the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. That means our sins have been dealt with. When Jesus died on the cross, He took your sin and my sin. When He went in the grave, our sin went in with them. When He rose from the dead, He rose to new life so you and I can have that same life. We've been born again to a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. Now notice this as we look at verse 4 and verse 5. We've been born again to. So we've been saved from, but we've been born again to something. To an inheritance that is imperishable, undefiled, and unfading, kept in heaven for you. Look at that now. If you know Jesus, the Bible says you have an inheritance. This hope that we're talking about is an inheritance promised to us by the King. Jesus included you in his last will and testament. And in that last will and testament, as he died on the cross, offers hope to everyone, everywhere who comes to the cross in repentance. He offers hope. And how does the Bible describe this hope? Look at it now. Imperishable, undefiled, and unfading, kept in heaven for you. Look at it, imperishable. That means that nothing can ruin the hope that you have in Jesus Christ. Nothing. It's imperishable. It's undefiled. It cannot be stained or cheapened in any way. It is unfading, meaning that it lasts. It cannot wear out. It is eternal, and it will not disappoint. This is the hope that we have in Jesus Christ. It is our inheritance. Imperishable, undefiled, and unfading. And then look what he says in verse 5. Who by God's power, he's talking about those who've been born again, who by God's power are being guarded through faith for a salvation ready to be revealed in the last time. So those who've been born again to this living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ are now, look at this word, guarded through faith. In other words, God is saying that when you trust Jesus, you are his child, you're in his family, and you are guarded until your salvation is reality and faith becomes sight. That word guarded is an interesting word in the Greek. It's a military term used of a garrison guarding something. The Bible says that God is guarding those. He's keeping those. He's keeping you secure. So if you know Jesus Christ, you have a hope. You have a hope you can't lose. Some situations are hopeless. Some people seem hopeless. Sometimes our finances are hopeless. But hope is never lost with Jesus Christ. Hopeless isn't in his vocabulary. Grace, mercy, redemption. We're guarded until the last time. So we're guarded until one day faith becomes sight. You see, the reality is there's bad news everywhere we turn. Bad news everywhere. The attacks in Brussels, the concern all over Europe now, ISIS in the news every single day. Even now in the state of Georgia, we are waiting, praying that our governor will sign a bill protecting religious liberty in Georgia. A bill that says it's probably not a good idea for men to go to the restroom at the ladies' room and for ladies to go to the restroom at the men's room. We lost all of our sanity. A bill that protects the ability to preach and teach the Word of God. If you look around at the world, things are dark and disappointing. If you look around at the world or watch a 24-hour news channel, you could be depressed and discouraged. You could feel hopeless. But I want you to know there's not all bad news. There's good news. It is that Jesus Christ offers hope to you and to me. To everyone in this world, Jesus offers hope. There's bad news everywhere. You don't have to go far to find it. But there's good news. The good news. You know the word gospel means good news? That's what the word means. The gospel of Jesus Christ. That God loves you so much, even while you were a sinner, Christ died for you. That even though my sin and your sin separates us from God, and the wages of sin is death, he offers the free gift through Jesus Christ. You and I, can be saved. We can be rescued and redeemed. The gospel teaches us that even though we deserve death, Jesus offers life and gives us hope in every circumstance and situation. The gospel teaches that any who will call on the name of the Lord will be saved. If you confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you can be saved. Talk about hope. That's the message of the gospel. And it hinges upon the reality of the resurrection of Jesus Christ. The resurrection was God's stamp of approval. It is the proof, the reality, that Jesus is the Son of God and that he came to save sinners. There are four major religions in the world today: Buddhism, Islam, Judaism, and Christianity. Each of these religions rests on a historical figure: Buddha, Muhammad, Abraham, and Jesus Christ. Over the tomb of Buddha, if you visited, you could write, "Occupied." He's still there. If you go to the tomb of Muhammad and see his bones, you can write, "Occupied." He is still there. Even at the tomb of Abraham, he is still there. But if you go to the tomb of Jesus Christ, you'd have to write, "It is empty. He is not here. He is risen, just as he said." This is what separates and distinguishes Christianity from any other religion or man-made philosophy. It is that God came to us when we could not reach him, that he paid the price that we deserve, that he lives today and offers salvation to anyone who trusts in him, no matter how hopeless you think it is. In the Old Testament, hope was promised. Many waited, praying they would see hope with their own eyes. Many died not seeing the hope in this life. People looked forward in anticipation to a day when hope would come. And then one day, hope was born in a manger in Bethlehem. He was despised and rejected by the very ones he came to save. Hope was nailed to a tree on the cross, beaten, battered, bloodied, and bruised. Hope was crushed. Hope was murdered. Hope was placed in a borrowed tomb. Friday, Saturday, Sunday. On the third day, hope burst forth from the grave. And today, hope lives, because you and I have a living hope, and our hope rests in a risen Savior, Jesus Christ. So no matter what you're facing or what you've encountered or how far you've been or the difficulties you've faced in life, I want you to know you can have hope. In this world, you'll have trouble, disappointment, pain, and heartache. But in Jesus, you find joy, peace, hope, and promise. I want to ask you.